Our first speaker will be Professor Recep S, who is now the Dean of the Ibn Haldun University in Istanbul. And our second speaker is Sheikh Abdul Hakim Murad, who is the Dean for Cambridge Muslim College. Inshallah, we will have both speakers giving their presentations, and then we have an open Q&A for questions for the two presentations combined, inshallah. So please do write down your questions and do not forget them. So without further ado, can I please present Professor Recep S?
Assalamu alaikum. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Sayyidina wa Habibina wa Tabibi Qulubina wa Shifa Qulubina Muhammadin. وعلى آله وأصحابه وأتباعه وإخوانه من الأنبياء بأرحم السلام أجمعين. I will talk about how to bridge the gap between religious and secular reasoning, because I think this is the most important problem students face in the modern university, because modern university is based on secular knowledge and Muslim students, they have religious knowledge. So there is a tension between the two. Unless they know how to bridge between the two, they have a great dilemma, and at the end they choose either one, either the secular knowledge and they abandon the religious knowledge, or they choose the religious knowledge and leave the university abandon it. So I believe that it is possible and necessary to combine both secular and religious reasonings. Contrary to what's taught today in the modern university, religious and secular reasoning, they are not mutually exclusive. Instead, they complement each other. This is what Islam teaches us. Is there a universal way to truth? So this is a question perhaps every one of us asks. Then we look at the human history. We see that until the rise of modernity, religions, civilizations shared the idea that reality is multiplex. It has multiple levels. There's material level and also the metaphysical level and the divine level. This continues until rise of modernity. And with modernity, it is claimed that there is only one way to know the truth, and it is the positive science. And it's based on materialist understanding of reality, that reality is only one level, it is the material level, and there is no metaphysical or divine reality. So, in my view, this is deviation from human intellectual tradition. I mean, everywhere in the world, from China to India to Africa to Asia to Europe, everywhere, you know, people believe that reality is multiplex. And only in the modern period is believed that reality is only a single level reality. So this is a deviation from human experience for so many centuries. And after 1970s, we observe post-truth period. They claim that there is no truth, there is no absolute truth, there is no universal truth. So truth is only subjective. When I was at Columbia University doing my PhD, one day one of the students asked the professor, how about the truth of this issue? And the professor said, we are not after truth in this university. If you are after truth, there is church across the street. You can go there. So that's the current approach in modern university. And if you compare the logical positivism, which characterized the modern period, and the post-positivism, which characterizes the current approach in the modern university. So the positivists, they claim that science is an objective, value-free and rational activity. Post-positivists, they say science is a subjective and value-laden activity. So opposite approaches to what science is about. The positivists, they claim that there is only one truth, and the surest way to truth is through science. And the post-positivists, they say there is no universal truth. Truth is paradigm relative. And the positivists, they say science is an ahistorical process. Post-positivists, they say science is historical process. And positivists, they claim data is theory neutral. There's a distinction between theories and facts, observer and observed. While post-positivists, they say data is theory-laden, observation is not theory-free, but it is interpretation-dependent. And the positivists claim that science develops cumulatively and progresses in a linear way, each new discovery adding up on the former ones. And the post-positivists, they say science does not develop cumulatively in a progressive way. It involves paradigm shifts. New discoveries destroy the former ones. And logical positivism excludes metaphysics because they see claims about metaphysics, they are untestable. That's why they should be excluded from any scientific activity. And post-positivists, they are more open to metaphysical claims. Another characteristic of the current university education is that it is very much Eurocentric. And this Eurocentrism, not only in Europe, but also in the rest of the world, in the Muslim world as well. So I call it self-centrism. This is a human tendency to evaluate different societies through standards of one's own society or through the historical experiences of one's own society. This self-centrism is also very problematic for the Muslim students because you know, if you receive a Eurocentric education, it involves praise, you know, for like Western civilization, and it always talks about the decline of Islamic civilization, and it talks about lazy native, and how non-Western people are irrational, lazy, they live in dark ages, and they have no history. So this is superiority of the West and exceptionality of the West. So this is also another problem in the current university education. And another problem with the knowledge offered in modern universities is that it instrumentalizes knowledge to exclude other societies. In particular, social sciences are used as tool of exclusion. Sociology tells us, you know, underdeveloped people, anthropology tells us about primitive people, uncivilized people, underdeveloped nations, etc. So they are used as a tool of excluding those nations, and most of those nations and countries are outside the West, including the Muslims. And when you receive such a social science education, you know, you are perplexed. What am I going to do, you know, with this? Is this science or ideology? You know, so this is the instrumentalization of science education. So what's needed is to think beyond positivism and post-positivism, and also thinking beyond Eurocentrism, because these are the maladies of the modern university education. So different civilizations have different worldviews and experiences. So we should not generalize one experience to all civilizations. And also different civilizations have different scientific traditions and legacies. So you cannot simply say one civilization's approach is objective, neutral, and universal, and generalize it to all of them. When we deal with the modern science, in particular social science, we should be aware of positivism, post-positivism, and also Eurocentrism. And if there is something empirically proven, we accept it. But when it comes to the interpretations, we reject it and come up with our own interpretation. But science is presented to us as a package, including empirical facts and their interpretations. So, with a critical mind, we have to separate empirically proven facts, and there's no problem with them, and their interpretations. When it comes to the interpretations of data, even Western scholarship, they have different schools of thought to interpret the data, so you can have your own interpretation. So you must feel free about that. So as an alternative to the current positivist, post-positivist, or modernist, post-modernist, Eurocentric approach, I am offering a multiplex societal science as an alternative to this. And I'm very happy that in the morning the speakers before me, you know, they have been laying the ground, you know, for this kind of approach. Multiplexity means that reality has multiple levels, and alternative world views, they complement each other in a non-reductionist way. So from this perspective, existence, knowledge, truth, and norms have multiple levels rather than single level. So this perspective, the multiplex perspective, does justice to different approaches and combines them in a multiplex understanding of science. So this multiplex social science is founded on an understanding of multiplex ontology and epistemology, multiplex existence and multiplex knowledge. Traditionally, it's called meratibul wujud and meratibul ulum. So meratibul wujud, multiplex existence, includes material world, non-material world, and the divine world. Usually, people combine divine world and non-material world as metaphysical world, but I separate, because divine God is a unique entity. It cannot be put in the same category with his creatures. We should keep it separate than the non-material world. So each level of existence, from this perspective, requires a suitable epistemology for it. So if you are studying material world, you need a suitable epistemology for the material world. If you are studying metaphysical world, you need a suitable epistemology for the metaphysical world. If you are trying to understand God, you need a suitable epistemology to understand God. So the multiplex ontology leads us to multiplex epistemology. So for the empirical world, we need empirical knowledge based on experimentation and observation. And for the non-material world, you know, we need rational knowledge, which is called nazar. And for the divine world, we need wahi. But these are not separated from each other, they always work together. And epistemologically speaking, maratib al-ulum, multiple epistemology includes sense perception, reason, and revelation. These may be called as objective sources of knowledge because they can be used in the public sphere, in the public domain, to argue something against other people. And also there are subjective sources of knowledge like intuition, dreams, inspiration, and also opening the eye of the heart, kashf. So these are considered subjective sources of knowledge because these cannot be used in the public domain to make an argument against other people. These are only in the private, personal field, and if other people want to accept it, they are free to accept it. Of course, these issues have, you know, great detail, but I'm just giving you the bird view about these things. So, how about the maratib usul, the multiplex methodology? Taşköprü Zadet, as Hasan Spiker mentioned about it, he's a great Ottoman scholar, Sheikh al-Islam. So, in his book, Mevzu'atul Ulum, he says that, you know, there are two methods involved in scientific academic study. One is reasoning, the other is purification of the self. Two major methods. But reasoning has two subcategories: pure reasoning, which may be called secular reasoning. He calls it nazar akli, secular reasoning. So revelation is not involved in this type of reasoning, nor is kashf involved in this type of reasoning. And this type of reasoning is used in philosophy and also by natural sciences. When you study nature, you use pure reasoning, by empirical methods and rational thinking. And also there's another type of reasoning which is called nazar shari. It is religious reasoning. And this religious reasoning is used in kelam, fıkıh and usulü fıkıh, theology and Islamic law, Islamic morality. It combines sense perception, reason, and revelation together. The other method, which is based on experience, spiritual experience, is called tasfiye or teskiye. It is used in tasavvuf. So basically, two methods, tasfiye and nazar. So how are they related to each other? And as Hasan Spiker mentioned in the beginning, these are complementary methods. They don't exclude each other. So this is the reason why they are called multiplex methodology. They complement each other rather than excluding each other. And depending on the subject matter you are studying, you choose one method and use it. So positivists, they give you only a single scientific method, experimentation and observation. But if you have multiplex methodology, in your toolbox, we have different tools, and you pick up the appropriate tool depending on the subject matter or the problem you are studying, either pure reasoning or religious reasoning or tasfiye. And the outcome of this system, the multiplex ontology, epistemology and methodology, is multiplex truth. Maratib al-haqaiq. So truth is not single, it has multiple levels. There is universal truth, and there is also subjective truth. So the positivists, they say truth is universal. Postmodernists, they say truth is subjective. They don't know how to combine the both. So they suffer from false dichotomy. But here, the multiplex truth allows us to combine universal truth with the subjective truth. And also the truth about material world cannot be reflected to the non-material world or to the divine world. So each level of existence has a truth about it, which should not be reflected to the other levels of existence. So rather than talking about post-truth, we should talk about multiplex truth. Because post-truth is a very dangerous concept. You know, if there's no truth, then social order, religion, morality has no foundation, you know, to build upon it. But if we talk about multiplex truth and bring together ultimate truth with a subjective truth, so this is a better approach to the issue of truth. And regarding the practical life, this multiplex truth is translated to our social life as multiplex norms, مراتب الأحكام. In the in like ethics and morality, binary logic is used, right or wrong, legal or illegal. You know, but in the multiplex norms perspective, you know, there are norms more than two. So let's say drinking water. You know, is this, what's the normative judgment about this? Or what value you can attach to drinking water? You know, you say either right or wrong. But from this perspective, it could be haram, makruh, mubah, sunnah, wajib, and fard. So according to Hanafis, nine values, one of the nine values may be attached to a particular human action, and according to Shafi, one of the five values may be attached to a human action. So this multiplex norm system is based on multi-valued logic. Rather than binary logic, it's based on the multi-valued logic. And in more practically, when a Muslim decides about what to do, you know, there is a level of legal thinking which is based on reciprocity. This is accepted moral, ethical, and there is another level which is based on tolerance and forgiving. This is also moral and ethical, and there is a highest level of morality which is altruistic. It's also considered moral. So a Muslim mind, you know, decides what to do based on this multiplex normativity, either to reciprocate or to forgive or do a favor based on the altruistic perspective. Technically, these are called Sharia, Tariqa, and Hakika. And from this multiplex perspective, how do we approach to what modern education offers to us? Briefly put, be critical but just. You know, don't throw the baby with the bathwater. Be critical but just. So avoid false dichotomies and binary oppositions, which is based on reductionism. So materialist or idealist, why not both? Religion or science, why not both? You know, reason or revelation, why not both? So this multiplexity offers us a very pluralistic framework in which we can accommodate seemingly opposite things and adopt a holistic and comprehensive approach to truth, to normativity, to science, to justice, to different approaches, and utilize their insights within a broader and comprehensive perspective. So if a scientist is materialist and, you know, focusing on empirical research, okay, he has some insight. I mean, we can benefit from his insight, but we should reject his reductionism. Because he's saying, oh, everything is matter. No, matter is only a single devil. So he's saying, we can solve every problem with empirical research. No, that's not true. Empirical research helps us only in understanding certain questions. And make a distinction between empirically proven facts and their interpretations. Accept the empirically proven facts and interpret them yourself through a multiplex approach. So five pillars of multiplex approach. First, objectivity is realized in subjectivity. Second, modes of thinking includes spiritual level of thinking, rational level of thinking, sensual level of thinking, and also group thinking, which is day-to-day life. And existence is realized as a reality beyond itself. So simply focusing on the material world, you cannot understand why is there something rather than nothing. Why is there this material world? You cannot understand it unless you go beyond it. And knowledge is a virtue. It is not a commodity to buy and sell. Unfortunately, modern education turns knowledge into a commodity. You know, Marx has this excellent theory about commodification. So he says capitalists, they expand in a domain of commodification. So recent phase of capitalist expansion was turning knowledge also into a commodity. So Islam, Muslims reject this approach. Knowledge for us is not a commodity, because from Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not sell knowledge to his companions. It was free. So Islamically speaking, especially religious knowledge is haram to sell and buy, because it is not a commodity. So knowledge is a virtue used for the betterment of the self and society, as opposed to knowledge as power. Science is held as a manifestation of a spiritual reality as far as human ability. So in practice, this multiplex and uniplex approach, when you compare them, so Auguste Comte is a good example for a single level uniplex ontology based on materialist ontology and empirical or rational epistemology is considered only one type of epistemology, and also he accepted only one method as a scientific method. And Descartes, you know, may be seen as a first level multiplexity because he believed in mind and body, two levels. And for the second level multiplexity, Al-Farabi could be a good example, because he accepted that there are three levels of single reality, and he accepted empirical and rational methods, but he used only rational methods. He did not use the others. And Ibn Khaldun, he accepted three levels of a single reality: Mulk, Malakut, Lahut, visible world, invisible world, and the divine world. And he also accepted empirical, pure rational, religious national, and also the Kashf, the Sufi method. Very few people know that Ibn Khaldun was a Sufi, and he also authored a book in Tasawwuf. And he implemented different methods, both empirical methods as well as, you know, other methods in his research. But he is not founder of positivism, because he was not reductionist in his ontology, epistemology, and methodology. And when we look at the sciences in Islamic civilization, we see that the ontological focus of philosophy is existence as a whole, and epistemological focus is reason, and it uses pure rationality as a method. Kelam also focuses on existence as a whole, but epistemological focus is reason and revelation together. And the method is religious rational, nazar shar'i. And fiqh is the same, you know, it focuses on the external actions based on observation, using reason and revelation as a source of knowledge, and also nazar shar'i, religious rational method, and tasawwuf, focusing on the internal dimension of human action. And epistemology focus is kashf, and the method is tazkiyah, purification of the self. So all these things end up producing a system of a worldview, and also a social system. At the center is the ontology based on three levels: mulk, malakut, lahut. You know, visible world, invisible world, and the divine world. And around it, the epistemology. You know, using reason, experimentation, revelation, and also spiritual, experiential knowledge. And the method methods include religious reasoning, pure reasoning, as well as the kashf, opening of the eye of the heart. And from this system emerges the following disciplines: fiqh, tafsir, hadith, tasawwuf, falsafa, kalam, ilm, umran. These are disciplines that are produced by this ontology, epistemology, and methodology. And the normative multiplexity, including fard, haram, makruh, you know, mubah, wajib. This is the normative multiplexity produced out of this. And at the end, we have what Ibn Khaldun called Daira to Siyasa, circle of justice, or circle of politics, in which all different systems are combined together, and all this system, the purpose of it is to produce what's called Makas to Sharia, the purpose of religion, the sixth purpose of religion. This system is set up to produce these outcomes. Thank you very much.